with my colleague and friend, Professor Ricardo San Martin, who is a industry fellow and professional faculty member in the School of Engineering at UC Berkeley, a trailblazer in education and a fellow traveler who straddles both academia, his own entrepreneurial pursuits, and the mentoring and encouragement of many young entrepreneurs. And Ricardo and I really share a love of the multidisciplinary opportunities that UC Berkeley community affords us. We just had this sort of amazing wake up, Ricardo, from Bjorn Ost, the co-founder of Oatly, who's now got an innovation lab in Sweden and in California, and he showed us a very intimate view of his bowel there this morning, which was
woken
up.
Yeah.
But tell us about what you're working on, and you know, I'd love to hear your view of the food tech landscape and the future ahead.
Okay, great. Thank you.
I'll come back in a little while.
Oh, okay. Great. So as Will said, my name is Ricardo, last name San Martin, and I work at the Center for Entrepreneurship and Technology from UC Berkeley, where we teach about 2,000 students per year entrepreneurial skills around relevant topics. And we have a program called Ultimate Program, which is a series of classes around all the emerging opportunities and challenges ahead, both in the plant-based space, and also we've looked a little bit in the cell-based space. We have like 40 students per semester, and we have companies that we work very close with, to mention a few: Mantiqueira from Brazil, major egg producer of South America, Merck from Germany and the US, and we have Nestle, and we have Givaudan, and we have smaller companies like Miyoko also working with us. So we have a very extensive network of venture capitalists and startups. So we have a conversation space. And the purpose of the program is to have a critical conversation around these topics and see what's needed and what the students need to know to innovate in this space. And since the time is very short, I'll just share with you some of my thoughts, what I've learned during these 4 years leading this program. And I think the first basic question we have is like, it's more like an ethical, philosophical question. It's like, if this plant-based foods will change the way of being in the world that we have here in the US in relation to animals and plants, and the way we see the natural resources as resources, you know, as something we have to use and exploit. So that change of behavior is always a permanent question for us. Will eating a plant-based burger in a setup like a McDonald's or Burger King will change the behavior and have any impact whatsoever in the world? That's something we want. Those are the questions we ask. Are those products healthy? Are those products sustainable? And we try to read very critically the narrative of the industry around that. That's one aspect of our work. But since this talks about the technological challenges, we always ask the question, who are we designing these foods for? And because who are we designing the food for setups the complexity of these challenges. So if I have, for example, I'm thinking just on a substitution, then that's a kind of problem that needs a certain technology and a certain understanding about food and about plants that is very deep. You cannot innovate in this space. You cannot lead in a company in this space unless you know the underlying science behind both the animal-based products and also the opportunities the plant-based offer or do not offer. So understanding what are we going to design, is it going to be an imitation of something that exists, or is it going to be something new and novel that we don't know about and the students will come up with? So that sort of sets up the scene. For example, let's say you are trying to come up with a plant-based cheese, right? Will it have the functionality of cheese, or it will just be a spread made of nuts that are being fermented? Will it melt? All that needs a very, very profound understanding of rheology, of microbiology, of food microstructure. And there's no way you can innovate in this space if you don't team with people that know that and you understand the language. So for all of the students that are out there that are looking for opportunities in this space, it's super important that you educate yourselves in food science applied to plant-based foods, because if not, it will be impossible that you will understand what the people you're working with are doing or where are they going. Another major concern about the design of the food we're going to design is about affordability. I've seen many companies, some of them coming from our class, where the affordability is not part of the design's constraints. So the products they come up with, they're really for an elite. So it's different to design for Palo Alto than to East Palo Alto, or even from Berkeley to Oakland. It's very different to design products for the US in general than for Central America. Will they have to be refrigerated or not? I mean, all those issues, when you contrast the narrative of the industry that says, oh, we're changing the world and the world and the world, is really a huge space. And we all eat, but we all eat different things. And food means different things for all of us. So we place a lot of importance in what really are going to we're going to design, what are the design constraints that product or service has. And based on that, we start looking at the technology and the science behind that. And I would say that to innovate in this space, to come up with new products, it's going to become harder and harder as time passes, because the palette or the kind of raw materials that plant have offered us today are not exactly the ones that are going to mimic or reproduce the the functionality that those same molecules have, or similar molecules have evolved in the animal world. So if you want, for example, a cheese, as I said before, that really melts, well, that could look more like a cheese, and you have to understand really well casein and why casein behave the way it behaves, why casein has, what purpose casein serves in our evolution. And if you understand that and you try to replicate that with plant proteins, then you realize that it's going to be a really hard issue to do, because plants evolve with a different purpose. So you could match the protein content or the amino acid and do something about that, but not the functionality of those molecules. So one of the main challenges we have now is this lack of many of different raw materials. Maybe it's a handful of raw materials we have, and that's it. And not all of them will serve the functionality we're looking for. Time. Chick, chick. I saw your face, Will, here.
Well, I did. I'm so fascinated. I just wanted to engage you.
Because
you talked about the microbiology, the biology, the chemistry. What about botany? What about the appreciation of the plant?
We're trying to incorporate more and more of that in the class, because the class is called plant-based foods and plant-based, but what do we know about plants? You know what? Plants is like they forgot. And when you look into plants and their structure and their the functionality of the proteins that are found there, you will get surprises. We need to know a lot more about plants than we know today.
Yesterday, we had a presentation from the chief scientific officer at Plenty, mm-hmm. who presented a very technocentric view that it was all about human beings being able to control natural processes to create. And it set me back a little bit, honestly. Just it was coming from a place of almost like manipulation as opposed to appreciation of a system that honestly many of us believe is still full of mystery and unknowns.
Yeah,
So
I cannot more than agree with you. And you can see that reflected in the students. You know, the more they learn how some of the more processed foods in this space are made, the more they want to get away from that. And now we are more looking into like minimally processed foods and the use of fermentation to modify them naturally. But this try, I mean, you know, the soy looks very different than a steak. So to try to get from a soy to a steak, I mean, you really have to do a lot of processing.
yeah.
And that's not necessarily good. And the other thing that's limiting is like what grows where you are. You know what I mean? What can be grown? Because this semester we're going to have a challenge for the Department of Defense. And they say we can only use crops that go, these are for combat troops, ration. You can only use things that grow within the US borders. That's it. I mean, you cannot import coconut fat, you cannot import palm oil for the you know, plant-based margarine or whatever it's called. You cannot start importing, you know, nuts from Brazil to do cheese spreads. You have to just restrict to the US.
So I love, you're an entrepreneur, and you know that entrepreneurship always happens most successfully in an environment with constraints. And so food is so complex. I mean, you mentioned all of the science and technology that people need to be familiar with, affordability being an issue. Now you're talking about geography, climate. Yesterday, the topics of course, the hedonic qualities, the taste, the texture, the deliciousness, that above all is what's driving, consumer adoption. And then, we talked about carbon emissions. Are the students thinking about life cycle analysis as they design these products as well? And are they looking at the carbon emissions that are generated through the whole life cycle? So
Yeah,
these are so many
there's so many
variables.
variables, you know. I mean, like the life cycle analysis. I mean, we don't have that many external assessments on the products that are there. Some of them come from the same companies, you know, white papers or
Right.
papers co-authored by authors from the same
Industry
company,
generated.
and so we don't know. And you're getting some voices of dissent now in the literature. Oxford University has published quite a few papers saying, no, I mean, there's not much water going into this, as it says. And you know, so the narrative also has been challenged. So it's such a complex, it has so many angles that,
But you bring, I just want to, for the students' benefit, there's a lot of questions here, like, how do I learn more? People are celebrating your class, your Challenge Lab is their favorite experience at Berkeley. So I just want to say that, one of the things I'm so happy and proud of is that our, student interest is sort of pulling in people like you and me and others who, exist in this space in between the hardcore academic research, which needs to be done, and the practitioner realm where the students are so activated. So how, besides sort of taking your class, my class, other classes on campus, how do you think people should go about getting prepared to operate in this multivariable innovation space?
I would say, I mean, something that there are not that many plant-based companies there that have a strong domain of what it means to scale up and to produce food. So going for an internship in a traditional food company, it will help, you know, and getting the background for that. But if you go to Del Monte or whatever, I mean, and work there and just see all the problems, all the contamination problems you can have, raw material supply, I mean, all of that. Here we are talking about food, tons of food. So I've seen many entrepreneurs that, you know, young entrepreneurs that don't have that. When the CEO of Nestlé came here and he looked around and he looked for, you know, the companies, the startups, he was amazed how many had any understanding whatsoever about biosecurity or biosafety or, you know, contamination of that. I mean, he said, this is food. I mean, you can get sued any day. So I would recommend students to approach the food world in general. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Get involved with the IFT, with the Institute of Food Technologies, and learn about food, because these are variants of food production, you know, and they're different raw materials, but still it's food. Yeah.
It's great advice. Yeah. Well, Ricardo, thank you for all you do for this program, for the students, and thank you for being a founding advisor of the Plant Futures Initiative. We really appreciate your involvement.
Thank you, Will, for putting all this together. Yeah.
Yeah. It's quite exciting to have, you know, over 200 people up and awake on Sunday morning.
201 with me, you know?
Yeah, 201. Yeah. So we'll see you on campus, I hope, soon, if not.
Yeah, and I think I have a breakout session or something like that.
Oh, good. Yeah, okay. We'll see you at the breakout session.